Well, a Scottish university is set to hand out badges to its students to spell out the pronoun they want to be known by. The he, she or they tags are part of an effort to avoid so-called misgendering. Now, the initiative's been proposed by Edinburgh University's Students' Union. However, it warns students should avoid using the term preferred pronouns, arguing it's not a preference but a necessity. Now, the issue of young people wanting to change gender has been increasingly stirring controversy. The UK's Women's Minister, Victoria Atkins, has expressed concerns over the rising number of minors now wishing to go through realignment.
I read in a paper recently that there has been a large increase in the number of teenagers who are identifying as transgender. And I think that we need to get down to the reasons why this is happening. It may simply be a case of greater awareness. It may be that for some, they see it as an answer to questions they are perhaps not asking themselves.
Okay, we're joined now live by Peter Tatchell, LGBT rights activist, and John Gaunt, a radio talk show host. Thanks for joining us, gentlemen. Good to have you on the programme today.
Hi.
John, if I could perhaps go to you first. Obviously, handing out these badges reflecting gender pronouns, the intention may be well-meaning to make students feel more welcome. Is there a necessity, really, though, for this, or does it add more complications to a time that's already quite stressful in young people's lives?
It's a complete and utter waste of time. It's an absolute load of nonsense. It's PC gone mad. However, if somebody wants to be spoken to and they want to say to me, I prefer it if you call me Mr. or Mrs. or Ms. or whatever, then fair enough, that's their freedom of expression. They've got a right to do it. But my freedom of expression is that I'm still allowed to say, well, you're a bloke if you're a bloke. And I don't understand why the English language should be dictated to by this radical minority group. You get on with whatever you want to get on with, wear whatever you want, but don't try and force it down my throat, because, frankly, I've had enough of the trans lobby.
Peter, John says he's had enough of the trans lobby there. Is this something you agree with, or is this necessary to make young people more comfortable in a new environment?
Well, I think we need to start by recognising that trans people do not choose to be trans. They don't make this decision about gender reassignment without very, very serious, long, protracted thought. And indeed, it's often agonising. They face often rejection by their parents, being thrown out of home, rejection by their peers and other kids around them, and indeed, very high rates of transphobic hate crime, physical violent attacks on the street, and very high rates of suicide and attempted suicide. So this is not a decision that a young person takes lightly. And if they make the decision that they feel that they are one gender or another, I think we should respect that. I don't think it's a big deal to... It's just about common decency. It's just about being kind and compassionate to other people. So I don't see the problem.
I agree with that, but by the same token, they should respect our rights to have a different view. And when you talk about this, this is always brought up, the thing about trans and suicides. Isn't it true, Peter, the majority of those suicides are people often who can't cope with the fact that they have trans, that they've actually had these physical, very demanding operations? Let's look at the statistics in truth, shall we, Peter? It isn't because they're struggling with the fact they think they're in the wrong body that leads generally to the suicide. It's after, when they realise they've made a dreadful mistake, which is why the woman's minister, or the education minister, is right to say we need to look at why more and more young people are trying to go through this. We need to look at why puberty blocking drugs are being handed out like Smarties to children. They don't know their own mind. I agree with you, Peter. It must be agonising. It needs time. It needs to be thought about. And they need to be of an age where they know that they are in the wrong body. Not giving them out to 6-year-olds, 8-year-olds and 10-year-olds. And you know that's happening, Peter, and it's wrong.
But, John, there are only about 300 young people who are having puberty-blocking treatments.
Per year.
Only about 300.
Per year.
That's a tiny, tiny number.
Per year.
A tiny number. Well, per year,
really?
Even so, but, you know...
At what age are age are they being given them at, Peter? 10 years old, 9 years old. You think that's good? Because I don't.
But, John, if I could just jump in here, I mean, the debate is about these badges being handed out in university. These people are largely 18. They're 18 years old, John. If I could just finish, John. They're 18 years old. They're legally adults.
Yeah,
surely
sure.
They can make the decisions about their bodies, about what they wish to be called. That's down to them.
Oh, yeah, excuse me, don't misrepresent me. I said completely. If they want to say, today I'm a man, tomorrow I'm a boy, the next day I'm a fridge freezer, that's up to them. But I don't have to fit into it. I don't want to get into a situation where I have to change pronouns. I have to change the English language, as Peter says, for a minority, a very small minority. They are attacking my freedom of speech, my freedom of expression. I don't believe that they are
John,
I'm entitled to that opinion.
John does have a point, doesn't he, Peter? I mean, what would be wrong, for example, with handing out simply name badges to people? You would be Peter, Mr. Tatchell, I presume. John would be John. I would be Daniel. Somebody else would be Mary or Susan. Would that not be equally effective at dealing with the situation?
Well, I think the purpose of these badges is just to raise awareness, and in particular, to make trans students and their friends and allies feel comfortable, safe and accepted. I don't think that's a terrible thing. I think it's just a common human decency to be kind to other people who have made this decision.
Okay,
I think, Peter. What's not reasonable, hang on a minute, where universities are trying to tell lecturers, it's happened at the University of Toronto, of course, famously with Jordan Peterson, where they told him he had to not use things like, hello, ladies and gentlemen, hello, boys and girls, hello, lads and lasses, that he had to fit into these new pronouns. That's what I object to. I don't see why we need to change the English language for that. I agree with Peter about being kind. My daughter was at art school with a boy who identified as a woman some days and as a boy other days. She told me when I met him to be polite and, you know, not to take the mickey, and I did so, of course. That isn't a problem. But it is not right that these people can do this. And whilst I talk about my daughters, it's also not right that these men who suddenly identify as women can go into women's refuges, can go into women's changing rooms. I object to that, just like many, many feminists.
John, if I can jump in, if I can jump in and get a question to Peter on this, because John raised an interesting point, didn't he? The question of young people, children, seeking to change gender, and as that women's minister sounded the alarm over that, an increasing number of them are, even though you say it's only 300 a year. Should children be encouraged, though, to make such drastic, life-changing decisions at such a young age? I mean, you have to be 18 years old to even get a tattoo in the UK. Why should they be given these drugs and these medical procedures when they're not of legal age yet?
Well, no one is encouraging them, and nor should anyone encourage them. This is a call that's coming from the young people themselves who've wrestled with the very, very difficult decision about their own gender identity. They've come to the decision often after a great deal of internalized shame, guilt, pain and suffering that they are a different gender from which they were assigned at birth. And I think we should be understanding and sympathetic to those people. And I think we should acknowledge that this is not a whim. And it's not true that people will one day be a boy and next day be a girl. That's not true at all. Those people, if they do exist, they're certainly not. They're not transgender. They're not transgender.
Peter, you're making this up. In the Daily Express article, which this item is now based on, when they talk about the badges at Edinburgh University, did you not read it? Did you not do your research? It actually states clearly they can change their gender, their description by the day. And the example I gave was sympathetic. I wasn't taking the mickey out of this young man, young woman, however he wants to identify. I was purely making the point. They are allowed to do that.
I think
we have freedom of expression. We have freedom of speech. But I have a right also to say I'm not changing my language for them. And I don't think anybody knows their own mind before puberty, Peter, when it comes to sex. And I think it's a very dangerous line to go down to suggest they do. And I think it's shocking that 300 children, minimum, are being given these puberty-blocking drugs. That means they must be, on average, 9 or 10. That's wrong, Peter. It's totally wrong.
Well, John, for a start, it's very clear that these puberty-blocking drugs are not irreversible. They are reversible. You can only have irreversible gender reassignment surgery and other treatments once you are an adult. So there is a proper protection there. But, you know, what Edinburgh University is doing If they have said people can change one from one day to the next, that's quite clearly absurd. I agree with you. But, you know, people who are trans don't let me finish. People who are trans don't change from day to day. Some may feel they are trans, and after a number of years, they may decide they're not, or vice versa. But this is over a number of years, not something day to day. So I don't think we should trivialise it.
No, but
we
you do know, Peter. I'm not trivialising it, Peter. You do know there's a massive move to people to be able to self-identify, and that some people do change day by day. All I'm trying to say is, let's be reasonable. If somebody feels they are, you know, being assigned the wrong gender, they're in the wrong body, I have enormous sympathy for them. And of course we should care for them, especially if they're very young. Of course we should. But we shouldn't be kind of, I don't really want to use this word, but encouraging it, which is what Edinburgh University is doing. And it's a massive difference between that and somebody who's homosexual or lesbian. It's just a nonsense. And I'm afraid a man who has his penis taken off is not a woman. Well, I agree with Jermaine Greer. If you haven't bled, you're not a woman.
If I can jump in, John here again, because
you are a trans woman.
You've raised another interesting point, John, haven't you, about how society has moved on over the years. Do you not worry that in a few years' time, people of your age, probably people even of my age as well, that have these views, maybe you look back as people who are now homophobic or racist? Society has moved on. We've accepted these people.
I see.
Do you not buy that argument?
I see. Yeah, I do. So the only minority, although unfortunately for you, young man, it's a majority. The only majority we can be prejudiced against, as just defined by your question, which I found abhorrent and I found insulting, was that you were trying to say I'm an old fart. That's what you're trying to say with your fancy words. Well, no, I disagree with you. I think I'm the majority voice, and I think you should apologise to everybody who's over 50. I don't know what age you are, but how do you think you can be so ageist? What a disgusting thing to say.
John, that wasn't my...
You might be seen as homophobic... Hang on, I haven't finished. You might be seen as homophobic seen now. I haven't got a homophobic bone in my body, my friend. I've got no problem with feminists or lesbians or homosexuals at all. I've got a bit of a problem with trans, but for you to characterise it as it's to do with my age, you owe me an apology.
John, obviously no offence was caused in my question. If you heard me afterwards, I also said people of my age. I'm around 30, seeing as you asked.
You're 30. You suggested it was my age. That's what you did. And what you did, I'm sure Peter will agree with me, that was ageist and you shouldn't do it. You are wrong, young man. I knew you weren't 50. I can't see you because you know I'm in a remote studio, but I presumed you were about 30. You're not the same age as Bill Dodds, who wouldn't dare have asked that question. You owe me an apology.
Well,
My point was... is that people who, as you said yourself, you have a bit of a problem with trans, that's a quote that you just said, in the future, people that do have some sort of questions to be asked about trans people, will they not be viewed by people of a younger generation as the people who perhaps 10, 15, 20 years ago would have been viewed as homophobic?
Yeah, let me tell you what's going on in our society. With the growth of social media and, of course, the absolute desire by these new media oligarchs to silence any voices of the decent, silent majority, i.e. the right in politics, not the far right, the right, this is going on. But let me tell you, young man, just for a moment, there are many young people who are being cajoled and bullied into all this nonsense. It is not about age. It is not about age. I come from a very theatrical background. I studied drama and theatre. I meet these people. I know I haven't got a problem. I have not got a problem. I've got a problem, let me just clarify, with the trans lobby, not with individual trans.
All right, John, Peter, if I could just get a final comment from you, but we are running out of time, just very briefly, if you can, sir.
Yeah, I think whatever John thinks, trans people are a reality. They've existed since time immemorial all throughout history. I think the fact that there are more people coming forward is because there is greater social understanding and acceptance. The stigma and guilt is fading away. The issue is being discussed more openly, and that is why more people are coming forward and identifying as trans. But it's still a tiny, tiny minority, a minority that is no threat to anyone.
Okay.
I think we should live and let live and accept that people who are different, for whatever reason, including because of their gender identity, that they have a place in the human family.